So, before speaking about mathematics, let me congratulate Kit Neir on the occasion of his 60th birthday, and let me wish him many more fruitful and nice years for the good of mathematics.
Thank you very much.
Okay. So, as you see, I will speak on quasi-random graphs and pseudo-random binary sequences, the connection between the two, that I will show that having good having binary sequences of good pseudo-random properties, one can give explicit constructions for so-called quasi-random graphs. All that I will speak about today, it is joint work with Jozsa Borbé, or paper is about to be submitted to the combinatorica. I wrote a little optimistically in the text of the Wilmer talk that it has been submitted already. It has been written up, but the typing is not ready yet, unfortunately. But anyway, it will be submitted there. Okay. So, in the first half of my talk, I have to give, unfortunately, some of definitions and notations. First, let me speak about pseudorandom binary sequences, whatever is needed from that subject. In 1997, Christian Modui and I proposed a new constructive and quantitative approach to study pseudorandomness of binary sequences. There are many definitions of pseudorandomness of binary sequences, many approaches. The one that I will present here is the one what is needed for giving explicit constructions for graphs with pseudorandom properties. Okay, so first, we introduce measures of pseudorandomness of binary sequences of the type in formula 1, that is consisting of minus 1 plus 1. Of course, in the practice, usually we have bit sequences, which are also binary sequences, but it is better to work with minus 1 plus 1, because then usually the formulas are shorter, because the expectation is very frequently just 0, so one term less to worry about. Now, so as I said, we introduce some measures to measure the pseudorandomness of such sequences. The most important of these measures is the so-called correlation of order k, which is defined for a sequence of the type 1 as the maximum of the absolute values of the sums that you see there in the sum, where the condition under these, it just means that all the subscripts of these in the sum should belong to the interval 1 and all the EIs have subscripts between 1 and n. Kassany, Modui and I showed that if n goes to infinity, then for a truly random binary sequence EN of type 1, the value of the correlation of order k for fixed k is around square root n. Now, this result has been sharpened by different authors. For example, there was an important paper written by Alon, Kohayakawa, Modui, Moreira and Rödl. Actually two papers, and later Eisleitner also added some nice sharp results. But anyway, for us just now, it is enough to know that for a random, truly random sequence, we are around square root n, this correlation are around square root n, so that if we know that the correlation of order k is of about this order of magnitude, or at least not much greater, then we may consider this as a strong pseudo-random property of EN. In the text, I will abbreviate the word pseudo-random by PR. Since that, more than 200 papers have been written along these lines, and the important thing is that in many of these papers, many explicit constructions have been given for large families of binary sequences with strong pseudorandom properties. In most of the cases, finite fields are used, and CRM plays an important role in the majority of proofs. But there are also other tools used too. Now, recently, Borbély and I realized that these results on pseudorandomness of binary sequences can be also utilized for giving explicit constructions for graphs with strong pseudorandom properties. In my talk, I will speak on our first results, which will be submitted one day to the Journal of Combinatorica. The importance of giving explicit constructions for graphs with strong pseudorandom properties is explained in many important monographs and papers written on random or pseudorandom graphs. For example, the monographs of Bolobash and Alon and Spencer, and also there are a couple of papers where related notions are introduced. The notion of quasi-random graphs was introduced by Fan, Chung, Graham, and Wilson, and Thomason studied, he used the terminology pseudo-random graphs. In particular, he introduced the notion of P alpha jumbled graphs. Now, in these papers, the authors say that an explicit construction may shed more light on the corresponding problem, graph problem, or in another monograph you can read that explicit constructions are more illuminating than existence proofs, which is certainly so. And it often happens that a random-looking structure is useful for a certain algorithmic procedures. So these are the reasons why this sort of pseudo-random graphs or quasi-random graphs are studied. In spite of all of this, in the most related papers and monographs, you find more or less the same few explicit constructions of for graphs of good pseudo-random properties. What you always find, that's the most important, it is the Paley graph, the so-called Paley graph, that I will define later. And there are also a few more constructions, some of them use linear algebra, altogether 6, 7, 8 constructions, and that's all. The intensive study of pseudorandom graphs started in 1987 and 89. In two papers of Fenchang, Graham, and Wilson. As I said, they introduced the notion of quasi-random graphs, and in two papers of Thomason, who used a different terminology, P alpha jumbled graph. It is too complicated to define it here. And they also presented a few more constructions, but not much more. In our papers with Borbély, our goal is to propose methods for constructing explicitly given pseudorandom graphs and to present large families of them. Let me emphasize once more that in our papers, and including the first one which we have just finished, we are focusing on explicit constructions. In particular, in our first paper, we focused on the quasi-randomness approach of Chung, Graham, and Wilson, since it is simpler and more transparent than Thomason's approach, which we will study in part two and later. Actually, I think Thomason's first paper appeared a little earlier than Chung, Graham, and Wilson. And anyway, I like Thomason's paper better, but the Fenchang, Graham, Wilson paper, as I wrote there, is simpler, more transparent, so it is easier to and more reasonable to start with that, to write the first paper on that. Now we will need the following definitions, notations, and facts. The first definition is the definition of adjacency matrix of a graph G sub n. The subscript it usually denotes the number of the vertices, and don't forget that we will speak all the time on undirected graphs. Suppose the vertices of the graph are capital V, this set is denoted by capital V, and the vertices themselves are denoted by V1, V2, Vn, and it is defined as an n by n matrix, I will use this notation all the time, whose elements are denoted by aij, which is defined for ij between 1 and n, so that the value of this aij is 1 or 0, depending on that, whether vi, vj are joined or not. Now, this adjacency matrix has the following properties, as it is easy to see. Every element of it is 0 or 1. Clear. The elements in the main diagonal are zero, which means that no one is connected with itself, and it is symmetric, which means that the graph is undirected. So these three properties are the basic characteristics of the adjacency matrices, and clearly every undirected graph uniquely determines its adjacency matrix and vice versa. Every square matrix with these three properties uniquely determines the graph whose adjacency matrix it is. This means that if we want to define a graph, then a simple way to define it just to give it, to present its adjacency matrix. This is what we will do later. In their papers, Fan, Chung, Graham, and Wilson studied graphs with vertices and edge density 1 over 2, which means that about half of the potential edges are taken in the graph. As they say in their paper, the main doing is that they introduce a large equivalence class. It means of graph properties, it means that they define seven graph properties, all of which are shared by so-called random graphs. So the random graphs possess these seven properties, and unlike random graphs, however, it is often relatively easy to verify that a particular family of graph possesses some property in this class. So it means that it is your choice what property to pick if you want to show that the graph is quasi-random. And these properties are quite complicated. Eigenvalues of the adjacency matrix come into the picture, then different other graph properties. So we will need just one of them, that's that we will use and we will refer to. It is the sixth property, which says that if we define the function s of ij, as you see it up there, then this sum that, no, that this sum that you see here is little of n cube. What does this say? So we expect the expected value of such an function Sij is around n half, which means that if we take the elements standing in the ith row of the matrix, of the adjacency matrix, and the jth row, then in the x column, we have the same things, either both are one or both are zero, which happens with probability 1 over 2. There are n rows and columns, which means that the expected value of this function is n over 2. Now, if this is small, as it is expected, then there are constant times n squared terms in this sum, constant times n squared times little of n, it must be little of n cubed. Of course, for a truly random graph, more is true, much smaller than this n cube, but anyway, it must be little of n cube. So here it is explained, what does this mean in words. Chung and co-authors proved the following theorem, theorem E. These seven properties listed by them are all equivalent. And based on this theorem, they introduce the following definition. The quasi-random graph, the notion of quasi-random graph is defined in the following way. Graphs having any, and therefore by this theorem E, all of the above seven properties will be called quasi-random. So it means that if we want to show that a certain graph is quasi-random, it is enough to show that one of the seven properties holds for this graph. Our goal was to construct quasi-random graphs in our first paper. Later we will switch to more general pseudo-random graphs. So in our first paper, goal was to construct quasi-random graphs starting out from pseudo-random binary sequences. As I said, the simplest way to define a graph is to define it by giving its adjacency matrix. However, this would mean that we want to make random type two-dimensional structures, the matrices, the adjacency matrices, from one-dimensional ones, that is from sequences, which may seem a wrong approach, so it is not clear how to make something two-dimensional out of a one-dimensional one. So it is sort of suspicious. However, this will be clearer if we take a look at on the Paley graph that I mentioned earlier, which is the most important example for a quasi-random graph. So a look at that may put us on the right track. The definition of Paley graph is the following. We take a prime Q of form 4k plus 1. I will explain this, why do we know the primes of this form. And then the adjacency matrix, using this usual notation, is defined so that its aij element is 1 if j minus I over Q Lejeune symbol is plus 1 and it is 0 otherwise. Now, we said that the Paley graph is a quasi-random graph. It means that its adjacency matrix must be symmetric anyway. And the symmetry property holds by the reason that Q is of the form 4k plus 1. This means the distribution of the Lejeune symbolum from 1 over Q to Q minus 1 over Q, symmetric. For example, if Q is equal to 13, then this matrix looks like the one above. And we may observe that it has two important properties. In the first row, we have one if and only if the column index j is such that j minus 1 is a quadratic residue. So the quadratic values of j minus 1 over q follow each other. And secondly, we get every row from the preceding one by shifting it to the right by one position cyclically. By this I mean, if we shift everything to the right, suppose we shift the first row to the right by one space, then of course the first space in the second row gets empty, but on the other one there is one at the end of the row, which is beyond the matrix, so this we remove to the first position from the beyond the end position. So we have to start out from these properties when we construct. Now about the first row, about the first observation, it is clear that if we start out from the sequence of the Lejeune symbols modulo 13 and you put a zero in front, Then we write up the values of these run symbols, plus one, minus one, as it follows. And then in the third row, we change every minus one in the second row for zero. We replace minus one per zero. And then observe that we get the first row of the matrix that I wrote up. So indeed, there is a Legendre. So this Legendre symbol sequence becomes a bit sequence, which is exactly the first row, the adjacency matrix of the Paley graph. Now about the second property that we observed before. We need the definition of circular matrix, sometimes also called cyclic matrix. It's a square matrix whose each row vector can be obtained from the preceding one by rotating it one element to the right or shifting it to the right, the same thing. And then we get a matrix of this form, denoted by capital Z, that you see there. So the second row is just a shift of the first row in the cyclic way and so on. Such a circular matrix is uniquely determined by its first row that I denote by capital Z sub n. And then we will say that the circular matrix Z in the second formula is generated by the sequence, by the binary sequence Z3, Zn in the formula 3. Moreover, we will denote, how can I remove this thing? This last. Is that simply a way to remove it? Not really important, but why to leave it there? Aha, thank you. Thank you very much. So we will use this notation that you see there. Z of Z sub n, it means that the circular matrix generated by this vector here, this vector Z sub n. Based on these observations, we propose the following steps, the following method for constructing a quasi-random graph in general, following the way as the Paley graph is composed, its adjacency matrix is composed. First, we start out from a family of binary sequences, minus one, plus one sequences, with strong pseudo-random properties. In particular, you will see that the only really important pseudo-random property is the size of the correlation of order 2. It must be small. Then we transform the sequences into bit sequences of the form written in the second fact. Then the third step is to adjust these sequences so that they should start with zero, which is needed to have all zeros in the mean diagonal of the adjacency matrix. And the most important one is perhaps, so there are two really important properties. The first one is small correlation of order two. And the second most important is this property, this force property, that we have to take a suitable subfamily of these sequences, which consist of symmetric sequences. So these sequences must be symmetric from the two ends, which means it can be defined so that if we extend them in both directions periodically modulo n, which is the length of the sequence, then with respect to f naught, they have to be symmetric, as you see it there. Finally, we have to show that if all these properties hold, then it follows from the pseudo-random properties required, in particular the one in the first requirement. Then these pseudo-random properties imply that the subfamily described in the fourth this should be wrong. Yeah, it is in the fourth requirement, the symmetry. So we need the symmetry requirement. So then all these these are the two important properties, the symmetry and the small c2. If these two important things hold, and the rest is rather trivial, then for all the binary sequences belonging to the subfamily described in this fourth requirement are such that the circular matrices generated by them are the adjacency matrices of graphs possessing property P6, defined earlier, thus by the theorem of Chung, Graham and Wilson, these graphs are quasi-random. So this is the method, the principle, how to construct quasi-random sequences, and here is a general theorem which shows that indeed how to do it. So this is an exact way of putting it, that this construction works. And finally, let me show, this is a corollary of this general theorem, which says that indeed the Paley graph is quasi-random. And finally, a less trivial construction, here it is. So this is an application of a theorem of Guben, Modui and mine to give a large, to define a large family of quasi-random graphs. The point is that we have to take, So anyway, I think he is right. I understood it. So anyway, I was supposed to end it with a few examples, a couple of examples. This would have been the last non-trivial one. Anyone who is interested in it, so hopefully one day it will appear in the combinatorical. Also, I have the handwritten manuscript of four paper, and I have a typed up version of my B-method. Thank you very much for your attention.